Hello, people. Today I have with me a man with a resume spanning over 40 years of work in both live action animation and also a musician with roles such as Michelangelo in the 90s Ninja Turtles movies, Oliver on the Brady Bunch, and Choji on Naruto, Mr. Robbie Rist.
Hello, sir.
Hello, how are you doing today?
Quite well, thank you very much.
Doing quite well. Good.
Yes.
Don't want to be in a grumpy mood.
Well, you might get some of that too. You don't know. I'm very mercurial. I'll go from one end to the other. We'll see what happens.
Oh, good. You at least prepared me. All right. So, what is it that got you interested in acting?
I was a show off as a kid. And kind of complained my parents into it, and they got me in, and I picked up my first audition that I went on, and it was kind of off to the races from there. My parents were kind of hoping that I wasn't going to be interested in it, but after I did it once, I'm like, well, this is fun.
All right. What was your first thing that you remember working on?
First thing I remember working on was a student film. It was either for a UCLA or USC kid, and then I think the next thing was this Nestle's Crunch commercial, I think. It was something like that. And I mean, I did like, I don't know, 80 some commercials in my first 2 years of doing it. Yeah, and crazy.
Because I know one of your, the biggest thing I remember as a kid that you had was the Brady Bunch.
Yeah, but I mean, even that, I mean, I'd already done, I mean, the Brady Bunch, I think primarily is that it's just so in the bloodstream of America that you'd now be hard pressed to find someone who doesn't know about that. But I'd already done Love American Style. I'd done a pilot. I'd already done a John Denver special. I did a bunch of stuff before. I worked with Jonathan Winters before that, before Brady Bunch even happened. So I mean, we talk about the Brady Bunch thing, but that's because God, it was on th three times a day at one point. There are people that have seen these episodes 30 times.
What was the Jonathan Winters and the John Denver thing?
It was a Jonathan Winters special, and there was a cowboy bit he did where he did all the voices, but he had little kids acting as the characters.
That's really good. What was the John Denver thing?
It was one of his specials, and I was in a Dick Van Dyke does a magic trick where he puts John Denver in a box and I pop out.
That's really cool. What was it like? As a kid, was it hard doing stuff as a kid, like acting wise? Like, was it hard to take direction or anything?
No, I don't know. I could look at a page of dialogue and memorize it. And when you have something in your brain that's second nature, it frees the rest of you up to concentrate on other things. So I took direction really well because I always knew the material really well.
And as I brought up earlier, you're a musician too, and you
Yeah.
still are. And what is it that made you start being a musician?
I was again, it's all part of the early show-off thing. I mean, I was playing violin at 3, and I took up guitar at 6. I just I apparently art had a had a siren call that I had to apparently answer. So, music and acting kind of ran together. It just so happens that you'd be really hard pressed to find something that has the level of recognizability of, say, the Brady Bunch. I was doing music all along. Yeah, and I mean, I was able, like, in I did a 80s cartoon called Kid Video. It was about a band, so did some playing in that. At certain points, I'm on Doc Mcstuffins right now, which is this Disney Junior thing, and I get to, I sing in it. So I mean, it's all. I'm like Danny Kaye. Yeah, like except I'm not as good or as dead.
Well, at least, the good news is the not dead part.
Yeah, no doubt, no doubt. And and because I'm not dead, I can at least maybe keep getting better. He's not doing a whole lot of getting better.
And what is it that got you doing animated work, as you said, kid video?
I was on I was with an agency called Cunningham Escott DePini, and they had a print department, a commercial department, a voiceover department, and a little kids, you know, young people's department. And I was in the young people's department at the time. And whenever the voiceover people needed, kid voices for things, somebody from downstairs would, we'd go up to the booth and do it. And I started booking these things. And I really took to it because it appeals to the ADHD nature of me. You know, I mean, if you're doing a commercial, you're out of there in an hour. And if it's a cartoon, you're out of there in 3 hours. That gives you the rest of the day to do all kinds of things. So I really dove into it, and I got super lucky. I mean, one of the things that I talk about a lot of in this shambolic mess that I call a career is that I've been remarkably lucky.
Yeah, and were you a big cartoon person as a kid? Like,
yeah, I mean, I watched Saturday morning cartoons and stuff, but I was never much of a. I think more of my genre fandom went toward horror movies. Part of the reason I wanted to start acting is I was really into those Universal 1930s ones with, Karloff and Lugosi and, Lon Chaney Jr. Right. And so I was like, The Wolfman was like my favorite movie when I was five. there was something of, I don't know, I'm also kind of a melancholy dude. There's something about that werewolf story that, they can't really get close to anybody. It's a real sad, it's like, for the same reason I think I liked Bill Bixby's Hulk show. But, so I was really into that. And then, I'm still watching them. I think Human Centipede 2 is one of the most important films of the last 25 years.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it is. It is, because blood has been done to death. It doesn't affect people anymore. And it feces do.
It was because it was so shocking at the time.
It's definitely pushing the envelope of what makes people go, oh God, right. It used to be as simple as a guy, Vincent Price walking down a dark hallway and he walks into a spider web and everybody in the theater would go, blah. Well, it's a little, the spider web doesn't work anymore.
Right. Now you gotta be as gross as possible.
You gotta grab them somehow. I mean, that's the Eli Roth model and all of that,
Yeah, same goes with the Saw movies and things like that.
Yeah, But yeah, I still go back, watch the Friday the 13th stuff and all of that. I mean, 80s slasher films are just hilarious. They're unbelievably great.
Well, even now you think they're kind of like that?
Oh, I love them. Sure. As usual, it's never the most obvious. There's a movie that they did a remake of that's, of course, terrible because you don't remake something that's good. Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day.
Yeah, was that the guy with the pickaxe that was killing people?
Yes, yes. And the original movie from the 80s, they had this old guy, English director, and his name escapes me right now, this old guy, English director, and he'd never made a horror film before, apparently. And he was just like, well, it's supposed to be a bloody movie, right? Well, more blood then.
Bags.
Yeah, it's really terrific. Yeah.
All right. And, Because back to the voice acting, whatever, you've done both anime and cartoons. And yes. I wonder, do you have a preference for either one?
I just like to work. I wish the pay scale was better for anime. But other than that, I mean, it's all work. I just like making art projects, and I get to work with all these really, I'm stupid lucky, man. I get to work with all these really incredibly talented people. Mary Elizabeth McGlynn, who directed me for a bunch of years on Naruto. She's a great actor anyway, but she's also a really great director and she's super fun to work with. And so, these are the sort of people I get to, share space with, as well as in voiceover. I've met all these crazy old guy character actors who I've admired since I was a kid. And, I just like working with people and making stuff.
Right. And I know with anime, you've got to do a different process. You've got to dub over the dialogue. Is that difficult? Because it's kind of mixed with some people I've seen.
I've heard it said that people that come from a musical background tend to have an easier time in voiceover than people who don't, because you're doing a lot of the same things you do if you're working on a song. It's you know, it's do we it faster? Do we cut this little chunk out? And it has to happen super fast. And so for me, I can do it. Yeah, you know, and for others, I'm sure at least at first it's challenging. I did a I teach every once in a while. I teach voiceover every once in a while, and I taught a an anime night, and there were people that took to it immediately, and other people that were like, beep, beep, I'm in. Oh no, okay, you have to wait for three. Okay, here we, you know. So, yeah, it's. I mean, I think when you do anything in entertainment, somebody told me once, if you're going to be in entertainment, don't specialize. Learn how to do a lot of things, and so. Just being an actor is fine, but you'll notice that, you know, Hugh Jackman's a really good dancer. You know, he comes from musical theater. I think to know as much stuff as you can only helps the final product.
Right. And as I brought up that you were Mikey in all three of the Ninja Turtle movies.
Uh-huh.
And I was curious, how was that done? Was it recorded first or?
No, it was done like anime. It was, I was doing my performance to not only the lip flaps, but also the puppeteer's dialogue.
Hmm. So the puppeteer was actually in the suit talking?
The puppet, there was one guy in the suit, and then there was another guy operating the head. And that guy operating the head, I believe, or did they? No, the guy in the suit had the voice, and there's a microphone inside the head, and the head is being operated by another person.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so I'm the guy who did the voice before wasn't doing the surf thing at all. So I'm kind of doing my performance while listening to this guy who sounds completely different than what I'm doing at this particular moment. You know, it was a little like chewing gum and walking and patting your stomach and rubbing your head. But
well, like, was he like not sounding at all like Michelangelo, or was he just like,
no, he didn't sound at all. It was way more high pitched and kind of cartoony.
Mm.
Yeah.
And, were you all together when you recorded for that? Like, were you and all
no,
the other
they
guys
did, together? They did us one at a time.
So it was like anime, like you also were one at a time.
Yeah. One of the things I do like about the cartoon thing, at least on many of them, is you're in the room with the other actors doing it. And, you know, just like anything else, there's a lot of things in movies now where people are acting to tennis balls. It's just way more fun to interact with something. You know, I'm big on shooting things in camera. You know, the first Alien movie is just unbelievably great, and everything is in camera. Then, you know, the actors have to be on the set with the thing.
Right. But you were being Ninja Turtles. You're this episode hasn't come out as this is being recorded, but it's been announced that you're going to be Mondo Gecko on the Ninja Turtles.
Yeah, I guess so. I've at least done one episode. We'll see how the rest of it goes.
And was it like, were you working with the new Michelangelo? Were you working with Greg on the new show?
No. Oh, well, so you... not on that one. No. Was I? Yeah. Wait. Yes. I mean, it was months ago. I do these things. I walk out and I'm like, I don't know. Maybe I did something. It's like Chinese food, you know?
Yeah. And,
but yeah, I probably did if he's in it, you know?
Yeah. And because recently I noticed you were also in the Angry Video Game Angry Video Game Nerd movie.
Yeah.
And you were the voice of the alien.
Yeah, very cool. I contacted James Rolfe, I don't know, 7 years ago or something, after I saw his review of the third Turtle movie. It was one of easily the funniest things I've ever seen. I and it's a half hour long. And it's super funny. It's really, really great. So I emailed him and I'm like, you know, if you're ever doing anything and you need me for it, I'd love to work with you because I think you're just, you know, I think you're hilarious. And he was making the movie and he called me in and had me do a voice on it. It was super cool. And I have nothing but respect for that dude. I think he's the new wave in how movies are going to be done. He, you know, he crowdsourced it. He was asking for a certain amount of money, and he not only got that, but he surpassed it by about three or four times. And the movie, it's totally a low budget film. It's a B movie, but it's great. It does all the things it's supposed to do. It's got a really sweet center, even though it's, you know, all him swearing and, you know, being crazy and stuff. But the movie itself came out unbelievably great. I'm really proud to be part of it, actually.
Were in you I'm assuming you weren't the puppeteer, were you?
No, that was another, I was another turtle style.
Right. And I also saw I was looking through your credits and I saw you were in Sharknado. You were a bit part in
Yeah,
Sharknado.
I also wrote a whole, me and the director wrote a whole bunch of songs for the both of the movies also.
Were you in the second one?
Yeah, no, I'm not in it, but again, I think Anthony and I wrote like six original songs for it.
And like what like did you come in to like play this little bit part or were you asked or?
I've known the director, Anthony Ferrante, for a long time, like 25 years or something, and he's a little younger than me, and I started doing music on his earliest things that he was working on in his 20s, and and everything that he did subsequently. He's a really interesting guy. You know, he's really clawed his way to where he is. He keeps, you know, doing the next thing, and the next thing does a little better than the last thing. And so we were working on, you know, the Asylum does these shark movies, but they also do low budget knockoffs of bigger budget films. So there was a Hansel and Gretel film coming out. Anthony directed the Asylum version. And so we were working on songs for that. And around that time, I had gone to the American film, what's it, AFM, American Film Market in Santa Monica. And outside of the Asylum booth was this poster. And it said Sharknado, enough said. And I, the 9-year-old, you know, in my brain exploded. I'm like, sharks, tornadoes, this is the best thing ever. And so Anthony, we were working on the music for Hansel and Gretel, and he goes, you know, I've been offered Sharknado. And I jumped out of my chair. I grabbed him by the lapels. And Anthony's, you know, Anthony's sort of a, you know, he's big on personal space. He likes having his personal space. Grabbed his lapels, looked him in the eye, and said, "I don't know why. I don't know why I'm saying what I'm about to say, but you have to direct this movie." And he's like, "Okay, first back up." And, you know, and I'm like, "Oh, sorry." Okay, brushed him off. And then I went back and grabbed his lapels again and said, "And if you do, I have to be in it." So he, you know, and he said if he does Sharknado, we were going to do songs for it, and he said, yeah, all right, if I get it, I'll put you in the movie. And so he wrote this little scene for it, and then when I got on the set, he went, you know, the dialogue that I have is fine, but if you can think of anything better, you know, play with it, see what you can come up with. And so most of this dialogue in that is just me improvising.
Oh. Okay, I think that's cool that he let you do that.
Oh yeah. Anthony's a really he's a real actor director. He gets out of the way and goes, "Hey, if you got some way to make this thing play better, do it." Yeah. I mean, he, you know, I mean, he you know, manages he managed to get performances out of John Hurt, Ian Ziering, and the blonde girl from
Tara Reid.
Tara Reid. Right. You know, and are three completely different eras of acting. You know, John Hurd. John Hurd's been around for like, you know, ever. And you know, Ian, he's an 80s guy, Tara a little later, and you know, they all had different, you know, they all had different careers, you know. I mean, one of the things about working with art people is, you know, it's their job to be sensitive to things. And so some of them you can push around, some of them want to be pushed around, other ones want to be left alone. It's like this whole thing. And he's really great with people.
Yeah, and like, have you like, do you watch the things that you're in? Like, because I know some actors say they don't like doing that.
I don't. I watched Sharknado. Because it was my first on-screen death, so you know, come on, you know, I have to see that. But mostly, and you know, I wanted to hear how the song sounded in the mix and all of that. But you know, on Doc McStuffins, I don't really go back and watch a whole lot of those. And as entertainment, I probably would because I mean, I don't know if you guys have any 3 to 7-year-olds in your lives, but you know, Doc McStuffins is for 3 to 7-year-olds, but the music's really good. The shows are all really sweet. Every week that I get my little script and stuff to go over, I end up tearing up at the end of every episode. It's a really beautifully made show that I think exists for all the right reasons. You know, where you think, I mean, and I, you know, I'm not belittling the turtle thing. I'm very proud of the work I did on that. And I think it's a, you know, it's amazing that that thing can go on, but it was primarily created to sell toys. Doc Mcstuffins is selling toys, but also I have heard from doctors that they believe that this show is going to cause a spike in the amount of young women that go into science. And I'll take that, you know, I'll take that over the Transformers any day.
That's really cool. I honestly think I could honestly believe that with Doc Mcstuffins. It is cute. So.
Oh, it's adorable. It's really adorable. And like I said, the songs are all written by the lead singer of Letters to Cleo, Kay Hanley. She's amazing. I mean, you know, she got a really great pop sensibility and all that stuff. So, you know, the songs don't make grown-ups want to put a gun to their head.
Yeah.
You know.
I know a few shows. Dora.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you know, yeah. So it's I'm again, it's all part of this being lucky thing. You know, I get to work on these really great projects.
Right. And thank you so much for letting me interview you.
Oh, yeah, sure. No problem.
Is there any advice you can give to people that want to get into the acting business or voice acting?
Yeah. Well, if you're going to get into acting, learn how to act. And if you're going to get into voiceover, learn how to act. I say all the time, voice acting is the hardest acting to do because most of our discourse happens using our eyes and our hands. So if you don't have that, the performance will not come across. You really have to put those, you have to be, I would say you have, and that's not because I do it, but in my years in this business we call show, I have noticed that the best actors that I have encountered are ones I encountered in voiceover. A lot of them did on camera too, but really great actors do really well in voiceover because they're not just reading words on paper. They are in the moment. They are in the scene. They might as well just be being shot with a camera.